My name is Johannes Meixner. I work for SUSE and I would like to show you how to use Relax and Recover on your own laptop. If you do not have a laptop prepared already with two virtual machines, I will show it on my laptop, so you just watch what I'm doing. If you ever think about using Relax and Recover, it's mandatory. It's not recommended, it's mandatory. To do what I will show you now to you, create two virtual machines on your laptop and then play a little bit around with it. If you play around with it, with your first steps on your server with 2 terabyte of data, yes, you take very much time. It's not productive. So first play around with it on virtual machines to get some kind of feeling how this thing works. First, I will tell you about the preconditions for this playing around. How to install Relax and Recover, how to configure it, and then finally make a backup and recover on the second virtual machine. The preconditions are that you have somewhere an NFS server running in a way that the virtual machines can access it. And to start with it, I recommend to use simple virtual machines. I use it with BIOS. If you like to learn complicated things, try UEFI first. But if you like to get to see how it works, use BIOS. As I wrote it, a single disk, a usual CD-ROM drive, a single network interface card for your first tests. On the first virtual machine, a small and simple Linux system is running. This is the system where RIA will be installed and which will be recovered later. The second virtual machine is identical virtual hardware and it's empty. So we will try to simulate to recreate the first virtual machine on bare metal. Of course, it's not bare metal, it's bare virtual empty machine. How to install it? In my first talk in the morning, I already explained that RIA, Relax and Recover, it's the same, consists only of shell scripts. So you do not need an installer or something like this. Just copy the tree of RIA's shell scripts somewhere. To do it with the newest code, clone it from GitHub into a directory. It gets cloned into a directory called RIA's and change into this directory, or copy it as you like via SCP, via copy, whatever, or install an RPM package. There's nothing special. It's essentially the same. You get 200 shell scripts copied somewhere. I already asked before I started the talk, is someone here who needs to install RIA on his laptop to do what I did? Those who have it, who have their laptops already prepared, have now already RIA installed. This is true. Otherwise, I would stop here until it's done. Okay, then I continue. Usually, you need some other software to run RIA. On SUSE, for example, you need a lot of other software, Partet and all these things, but that's usually there. But what's not usually there on SUSE could be the LSB release package. On Fedora, it could be the package GenISO image. At least for me, it happened on Fedora 25 server. On Fedora 25 workstation, it was there. On Ubuntu, I was unable to connect to the NFS share, so I need to install some NFS-related packages. On on Ubuntu, I was unable to create the Rear recovery system because SysLinux was missing and IsoLinux was missing. So you will experience this. You run it, it fails, you see, oh, okay, it's just bash scripts. If there is a correctly packaged software package for Ubuntu, it should have appropriate requirements to pull in the required stuff automatically. But perhaps there is someone, but I tested it with the raw installing of the shell scripts, and then I noticed later. Nothing bad, that's how it works. So, on SUSE I experienced, it's good to have a file etc/rear/os.conf. If this file is not there, I do not get an ISO image, I do not get an initRD recreated during recovery. I didn't notice this for a long time because it always works with the initRD that is in the backup. But to do it correctly and as it should, you need this file to be created. When you install a Rear RPM package from SUSE, it will be done automatically. On Fedora, I noticed that SE Linux is, for me, I'm not a Fedora user, I'm from SUSE, is a showstopper. I do not know how to deal with it. There is in Rear some code that seems to work somehow with it, but I want to present here very first steps to get a result. So I just disabled SE Linux. And I noticed that it fails strangely, and then I inspected the log and I found no space left on device messages, okay, and I investigated what it is. Fedora has the usual TMP, temporary directory, as how it is called, not on the disk but in the memory. It's very limited, so Rear needs more space than what is there. So you just use another one, export the TMP directory variable to something which is big enough. So now more or less all the pre-requirements are fulfilled or should be fulfilled to start. And to start to configure Relax and Recover. To do this, you start with an appropriate example config file. Now it depends how you installed Rear. I go back. If you installed Rear as an RPM package, you use the files at the normal place in the file system, /etc/rear, whatever it is. If you installed from GitHub or by copying the shell scripts into whatever directory, you change into this directory where now the relax and recovery tree of shell scripts is, and then you do everything relative to this directory. So you change into the directory Rear, and then you leave out the initial slash. So that's what I did on SUSE with this etc without slash. So you must decide on your system if it is /etc or if it is in the Rear directory, the etc. So the same with the example configuration files. Assume you are in the Rear directory. You use it without slash, user share, whatever, an example file, and copy it to the Rear configuration file. The standard Rear configuration file is etc/rear/local.conf. And then you have to adapt it. The mandatory thing that you need to adapt is the backup URL. You set it to an appropriate to your NFS server and your NFS directory. That's this one. In the example files, you find a backup URL, but you need to adapt it to the whatever it is, the IP address, and whatever it is on your system, the NFS, the exported NFS directory. This is the place where Rhea will store its backup, and this is the place where Rhea recover will get it. Then I always use two things. I specify a password on the Rhea recovery system. When you recover, you boot a Rhea recovery system. It's not your original system, it's the recovery system. And the root password therein, I use always Rhea. It's not the root password of any other system. It's only the root password of the installation system of Rhea. And I'm lazy. I always let the Rhea recovery system get any kind of network interface. You do not need in the recovery system your full network configuration. You just need anything that Rhea can access this backup. Anything what's appropriate to access the backup. So if you have 20 network interfaces configured, one is enough, one that can access this in the recovery system. So, I think I'll show it later to you. I think I start now with a presentation how it works on a SUSE system and some specific adaptations I did. Before I mentioned, for Fedora you need a temporary directory with sufficient space. So because everything in Rhea is shell scripts. Also the etc rhea local.conf file is sourced as a bash shell script. You can type there any command you like. So to some extent you can do, how to call it? Not a static configuration, but a dynamic configuration. But you must try out what works. In the Rhea recovery system, not a lot of things won't work that work in your original system, but you can. So you can as well type this command export of the temporary directory in the configuration file. It is much better there than to remember such things and type it on the command line. On Ubuntu, at Rhea upstream, there is no real maintainer or contributor who tests Rhea on Ubuntu and looks that everything is set up correctly. I installed Ubuntu 16.04 or whatever it is, long-term support on my system, and found out that in the Rhea recovery system something is missing and I have no network interface. It's not a device file. ETH0 is not there. And so there's a big hammer as workaround. In the configuration file, I just load all modules that have been loaded in the original system. I run a command to in the original system to list me all modules, all kernel modules, and then I copy and paste that as configuration variable, and the Rhea recovery system will load all of them. I think I do not need all of them, but I do not care. I need one of them. This is the module for the network interface, and perhaps some, and this one perhaps too, but I do not know. I just load all of them. Then in Ubuntu I found out that UDEV daemon does not work. Perhaps it's only one line. If you know about Ubuntu, it's perhaps simple to get it working again. Again, I'm lazy. I need some device node files. There's a configuration variable. Before, the very first thing that is done during recovery, it executes this command. So hard-coded, there they are, and then it works. This is not there to show how bad Rhea is. This is there to show how good it is. Quick and dirty workarounds are possible for the experienced user. If you have been listening to my initial talk, You may remember this advantages, disadvantages. Rear is direct, straightforward, very fast. And you have direct access and direct control what happens. On the other hand, sometimes you need to be direct. Of course, rear should at some time be also available in Ubuntu and well tested there so that you do not need this hex. But if you have 200 Ubuntu servers, canonical servers, and you do not need to want to bother with how to do it exactly right in rear. Just do it quick and dirty for you, and you get your things done. So now it's time to show how it works. Pressing the right key, going here. So like in these cooking shows, I don't know if you know these cooking shows, I've prepared something already for you, and that's it. What I have here, I have some virtual machines. No Hoover, mouse Hoover. I have a Fedora 25 server, I have a Fedora 25 workstation, I have, this is from previously, I have a SLES 12, and I have an Ubuntu system. So the generic one can be deleted. This is from, yes. So now it's better. And this SLES 12 system is running here, the big terminal, the big Xterm. I installed rear, I think from GitHub or whatever, in a directory called rear as user root. I configured it. I have it somewhere. No, I show it. First I show it how it works and the boring configuration later, if you have questions. Then I call the main script, user has been rear, and I personally, I always like full verbosity. So I use all these debugging options, minus small d, minus capital D, and I let it make a backup. So now you see it's doing something. And the backup will appear. What rear does now? First of all, rear creates its recovery system ISO image. That's the messages of rear copying files, copying binaries, copying kernel. It gets copied into a temporary directory somewhere. A lot of files get copied there. And from this, rear makes a bootable ISO image. This will become the recovery system that you boot later. What? Yes. Okay. So, great that it happened. I know it, but so, yes. Rear creates. Oh, I can can use a mouse. That's great. Could not copy. So, rear creates a temporary directory, and where it puts all these things. And now it tries to copy it to the NFS location. So let's look at the NFS location. We can see how it is. Can you read it? It's a smaller font. It's okay, I think. It's okay. It's not very perfect, but it's okay. So it copies into a directory that is named as a host name. This one is in blue above the same. ls minus l Linux. So, and because I made this little mistake that in the morning I tested the recovery and it works. But then always QEMU wants to access this file, and it always asks me QEMU whatever of this virtual machinery environment to modify the file permissions to access the file, and it did. And now the Linux ISO is owned by QEMU. And here RIA runs as root, but the NFS directory is not exported with no root squash. So on the NFS server, the root appears as user nobody, and nobody cannot overwrite QEMU's file. It's nothing to do with RIA, it's my fault. So we do the following. We move it away. So it's I move it away only not to hack something, so to get it clear from the very beginning. ls minus l. So now we have no directory with this host name, and we can rerun the mcard backup. The same as before, now it will work. While this is working, where is it? Cannot move. It aborted when it tries to write the ISO image of its recovery system. And after the ISO image was created, as last step, RIA mcard backup makes a backup of the files. Then the backup.tar.gz will be created. So, making ISO image. Now I to NFS location. Now saving something to NFS location. Now the ISO image is there, and now the backup will be made, and you can watch it. How it grows, it's unfortunate to read. So now the backup will grow there. And while the backup is made, you can ask questions if something is not clear up to now, because we have to wait. Yes. In my first talk, I did not talk about it, but there is a configuration file where RIA is configured by a lot of more or less global shell variables. And the defaults are configured in a file user share RIA conf default.conf. If you have RIA installed or you do not have a laptop, so so in this file, all default configuration variable settings are there. And over the time it gets better, there are explanations what each setting does. And there is a backup, I cannot remember names, a backup underscore type or whatever it's called. And you can set this to incremental or to differential or whatever it's called. So if you have if you do your full backup on Sunday, and then each day an incremental backup, you have next Sunday one full backup and six incremental backups, and during restore you need all of them. If you do a differential, yes, imagine the word, then you have one full backup on Sunday and six differential backups, but each one bigger than the other one, and you only need the last one. So both is possible. And another interesting thing. This incremental backup is only possible with, or only tested by me, with RIA's built-in tar backup method. Perhaps it also works with rsync or whatever, but I never tried it. But RIA has support for a lot, for really many external real backup solutions. For example, Barrios. But I think Pareos has no, the Pareos implementation in Rear is strictly separated from the TAR implementation. So I cannot tell if incremental backup works with Pareos or if Pareos itself just works different and does not need it also. And fortunately we have Pareos people here who could answer such questions. Okay. Okay, I must repeat the explanation from the Pareos expert for the recording. And the Pareos expert explained Rear has two parts. First, it makes the rescue, the recovery system, and as a second part, it makes a backup. You can leave out the second part. Then the command changes from mcar backup to mcar rescue. And Pareos, when Rear is used together with Pareos, Rear is only used for the mcar rescue part for the recovery system and not for the backup part. So with Pareos, you do your backup with Pareos, and Pareos supports incremental backup and a lot of other things. So there's no problem. Just use a professional backup method that's recommended in professional environments anyway, not to do it with TAR, but to use a professional backup method and let Rear do what Rear is designed to do, the recovery system, and let the professional backup solution do what the professional backup solution is designed to do. Okay, so now we have this one. Now we have on the NFS server a backup and an ISO image. So to simulate that now the system has somehow gone, I shut it down. And I create a new virtual machine. This would the equivalent. You get a new piece of hardware because the old piece of hardware has totally crashed. So I create a new one. Generic. On the NFS server, I select this directory. The new virtual machine will boot from the ISO image of the, that contains the Rear recovery system. Ah, here is the emulator. Would like to own this file, so for the next time, I could change the permissions of the file, and then this message would not come. But that's the reason. Call it a little bit better. /12sp2ext4rear. So it's only so these are all only steps that I prefer to do to get my virtual machine appropriate for this. Create your second virtual machine as it is good for you. The only thing which matters is that it boots. No, that it boots. Ah, it had. Ah, okay. It has stored it somewhere else. It's not a CD-ROM. So. Now the second virtual machine has booted. No, this is a bootloader of the Rear recovery system on the second virtual machine. This is the Relax and Recovery bootloader screen. By default, it boots the first local disk. There's nothing on the disk, it would not help here, but to be safe, you cannot too easily recover your machine, because you remember my first talk? Recovery means reinstalling from scratch. So if you do this on a, not on a new machine, but on a machine that is in use, you get a reset to the backup. Of course, that's what happens. Below you can see some the command line, the kernel command line. You can even press the tabulator to edit this command line and append a parameter if you like. So, or you boot it. Strange. When the initRD is loaded here, you see a progressing dots and dots and dots. And when you had your talk, there was three dots and nothing happened. You use a different bootloader.
Yes, and
it's of course, and it's much better to not tell the user we are still living. It's not your problem. It's the bootloader is just silent, and perhaps you can configure grub 2 to be a little bit more verbose what it's doing. So. No, this is not exactly right. I do not know where Rhea has it from. This is not welcome to SUSE Linux Enterprise Server 12 SP2. No, no. This is welcome to the Rhea recovery system. I guess it has copied etc issue, etc whatever, so that you see this message. Interesting.
Maybe because we used not a RPM package.
No, it's always the same. I never noticed it, but it's the wrong welcome message. Welcome to relax and recover 4. Doesn't matter. Yeah? Yes, of course. This happens while Rhea makes its recovery system. It copies a lot of files, and in one of these files there's this message. It is the motto of the day issue. You find it. And on the other hand, it's not too bad. First of all, it tells it's relax and recover, and it's relax and recover for this system. So it's we can leave it as is and log in as root. It has no password. Again, we are not on the on any real system. We are in the real recovery system. So I always type ifconfig to see I have a network connection. Why don't... Just a moment. I must resize it to fit on the screen. So, nice. And now let's do the recovery. Now I do not rear minus. Small d minus capital D, recover. So things happen fast. Yes, I don't know. Know how fast it goes. Usually it's fast. I'm in my first talk, I said Rhea is fast. And now I must prove it. Yes, that's the important thing. That's the only important thing. You have 200 servers, and your foobar server does no longer work, and someone asks you, oh, my foobar server, no, the foobar service does no longer work. And then you know the foobar server, it's responsible for this. Oh, shit, the machine is broken, I don't know, something is really corrupted, don't know. You have in your rack a lot of separate spare machines. Just fire one of them up and get it with a backup of Rhea, and you are done. Yes, making the initRD almost takes longer than restoring the backup. But now you are done. System is back again. You can reboot now. It's terribly hard to read. Can anybody see something? It's not good. But it is as it is. So what does Rhea? First of all, something. Then. In Rhea, what is called layout. The word layout in Rear has a special meaning. It means the disk layout, the layout of the partitions. It's called since some years layout. So how many partitions do you have? How are they connected? The block devices, the lower level block devices, the higher level block devices, until you finally get block devices where you put file systems in. LVM could be in between or something like this. Rear supports it. So it creates partitions, it creates file systems, swap, and then disk layout created, full stop. At this point, the hard disk is prepared, and I must show it to you. And all partitions, in this case it's simple, it's only one, is mounted at a mount point in the currently running recovery system. And this mount point at rear is called MNT local. Doesn't help very much. At this mount point, MNT local, the backup will be restored. So all files from the backup end up in MNT local in the rear recovery system. Here you have now everything restored because the restore has already happened. And therein is your new created system. Do we have find mount? Yeah, we have even find mount in the recovery system. That's not, yeah. You see that you, in the recovery system, your hard disk, your partition device node file, devsdh2, with the extended 4 file system, is mounted at mount local. And there is your new system. So we reboot now. Everything gets unmounted.
Can I ask a question?
Yes?
Sorry, I wasn't present at the first talk, but so maybe somebody has already asked.
No.
What about the MBR records? Like, is that recreated during the recovery? Because if you are on a new machine, then that's not there.
Of course. That's the main task of Rear is to do exactly such things. Rear will reinstall the bootloader.
Okay.
It has 3 big steps. The first one is recreate the storage access, make partitions, make LVM, make file system, and then mount all together so that you have at one mount point the whole your whole hard disks. Then let's say dump all the files therein, and finally reinstall the bootloader in a change root environment, of course, in this recreated system. And this way you get it bootable. Rear does not explicitly deal with the master boot record. So there's no code, but grub install must do the right things to get it bootable again.
So there is an execution of grub install in the CH root?
Yes. Yeah. There's an execution. I removed the lock to recreate the initrd and to reinstall the bootloader.
Okay.
It's just a normal installation.
Right.
But it's an installation via bash scripting.
Right.
So okay. There's no generic difference between rear installing a system and just Yum, Anaconda, whatever it's called. The only difference is how the payload gets there. For rear, it's restore of a backup. Other tools install packages, whatever else. But the major thing is an installation. So I can log in. And voila. No big surprise. No, wrong window. So, okay. So, the system is back. it looks similar like the first one. And I get rid of this. So now let's try the same with Fedora Surfer. There's not much difference.
Another question, if I can. This may be a bit of a naive question, I guess, but is it possible to tweak the source of the recovery before doing the recovery? So let's say that you want to do the recovery after a disaster on a different machine, which is not exactly the same one. So maybe the disk is slightly smaller, or you want to install it on the second disk instead of the first one. Is it possible?
Yes, it's of course possible. In general, RIA is bash scripting, so everything is possible that you can, whatever you can do on the command line is possible. The only question is how complicated it is. Right. And in my first talk, I said, ideally use the same hardware.
Right.
But if you have a little bit different hardware, for example, if the disk is bigger, RIA will automatically detect it and tell you, oh, bigger disk, and then you say yes, and it will work. If you had before, let's say, 1 terabyte disk, and now you have
750.
You have 2 disks with 750 gigabytes, then you would do a little bit more. Because RIA cannot guess what the right thing is, and there's no code in RIA to guess such situations. Imagine you have had before a network interface card of type whatever, and now you have a totally different one. Then things can get really complicated. Perhaps you need a kernel module that is not there in the recovery system. I think all kernel modules are there. Okay, Gratian confirmed all normal kernel modules are there, but you have a brand new, very special, hyper-performance thingy, which needs firmware. Then things could become complicated. You have a kernel module, but you do not have the firmware for it. This is not the end of the rope, because if you set up RIA with remote access, you may be able to get this firmware from somewhere and put it somewhere and make it work. If you are clueless, it's a dead end now. It doesn't work. But you need a file system setup command. You want to switch from extended 4 to butterfs. RIA is small. Also, look at my first, the presentation is online. Look at my first talk. RIA doesn't. If there is no butterfs file system used, then RIA does not include the butterfs tools in the recovery system. And then things get tricky, more complicated, because you cannot call mkfs.butterfs, no such file. But if you know this in advance, you can tell RIA to include this or that program or this or that directory into the recovery system. And finally, I implemented something that you can do this more or less automatically. As a very first step, this did not happen here. In the recovery system, you have the same RIA configuration file, etc/rialocal.conf. So you can change it. If just a few adaptations, for example, for whatever reasons you cannot access the NFS server from the new machine, so you can move the backup or the RIA things to a place where it can access it and change the NFS server, the backup _URL parameter, to the new one. So you can always do something. And what I implemented is that you can even download, you can do it manually, but you can, it's in RIA that RIA can do it for you automatically, to download a TargiSet and just unpack this in the root of the recovery system. So you can change the recovery system as you like. You can, of course, damage it if you like, or you can. So this is intended exactly for your use case. Target hardware is a bit different. You need something special. You made a backup. It's now on the NFS server, and therein there is the ISO image. And for whatever reason you do not want to recreate it, or you cannot recreate it, or whatever, then you can later add something. But the crucial point is, if you are clueless and do not know about your systems, then it gets really hard. Right. But if you know, you can do so many things. So the more you use it, the more you like it. When you use it for the first time, it may fail with this and this little annoying thing. And then you learn, I must do this and that. And then suddenly things get really easy, and you have a lot of more possibilities than with some kind of fixed solution. You're welcome. Did it work for you? No?
No, because I had a small problem for installing some dependencies I need to.
Yes.
I guess Windows will never be supported.
Windows? Yes. Oh. Now, Vladimir's great, newest, greatest, hottest, not yet well tested feature.
I cannot even imagine how many devices can be Windows setup, but actually, if you're running dual boot, Linux with Windows, there is a backup method called blockload, which you can check it on
Vladimir, I must repeat all this. So if I tell it because of the microphone, nobody will hear you. Nobody.
You can repeat it. You know what it is about. Yes, Windows is important. Documentation, there are user cases that were tested. If you match such user case, you can try. If you have something different, you can try it as well and allow it to control.
Just this moment, I must repeat your question and his answer for the recording. So the question was, is Windows supported? The short answer is yes, the long answer is yes, but there's a brand new backup method, which is not a usual backup with where usual backup, I mean backup of files. This new backup method implemented by Vladimir is called block clone. And what it does is it clones a whole partition, your Windows partition, either with disk dump or with a more intelligent, NTFS clone. Because Rear runs on Linux, it has no idea what there is in this NTFS thing. And NTFS is complicated, and you do a bit wrong, and it falls apart. So it clones the whole partition, and it restores the whole partition. So Windows is supported, but only as dual boot, because you need a Linux system where you run Rear. And as far as I know, it does not work, it cannot work when Windows is running. So you have a dual boot system, you boot Linux, and then you block clone your Windows partition, and also the master boot record is taken care of, and then you as dump data blocks, you restore it. It must be restored on the exact byte where it has been on the disk. So small movements is deadly for Windows. So, but it should be supported, and I appreciate your feedback and your testing.
Why not I understand that now we need a drug with many. I understood why. But maybe we can imagine that later we can use a live CD for only marketing a single movie.
The question was if currently one needs to use a running Linux system to back up Windows partitions that are not in use. The question was if it's possible to use a live system, a live Linux system where Rear runs, and then do the same. I cannot answer this question right now, and I have no idea if there is sufficient user requirement. Perhaps it is, and it's open source, and then it can be implemented. Gratian, can Rear run as a live system on a live CD? Is this? Actually, it is a live image, more or less. You boot the. It's a rescue image, yes. So we are almost there. So if you contribute. It's often so the case. If you think a little bit, so you notice 99% is already there. You just need to put some pieces in the right connection, and then things fall together, not fall apart.
Well, just an appointment. You said that their backup is not for professional use. I think it's good for operating system backup.
Yes.
Not for the data backup, but it's good for production systems.
Yes.
Just backing up with Relax and Recover the operating system.
Yes.
Leaving the application data to pair
okay.
or data backup.
I would like to repeat something from DRLM main. What is how call it from a DRLM member. I mentioned that TAR is not a good backup solution or something like this. For the plain operating system, TAR is perfectly okay. But if you have terabytes and of huge application data, then perhaps TAR is not the right thing. And since Rear 2.0, there's a new way. If you watched it, there was one big backup and it was restored. Imagine you have 10 terabyte of database backup in this TAR, in this one single TAR. Then, and you restore on a powerful machine. Then you do not utilize the power of the machine because there's only one data source and you make the backup. So multiple backups and restores are also supported now that you can, first you reinstall the basic operating system, and then you can restore multiple backups at the same time. So there is no limit. The only limit is how fast your hardware can do it. So time is up. I'm finished. Thank you very much for attention, and please try it out.